I'm Chief Petty Officer Herb Josie. This week on Navy Marine Corps News, the Commandant of the Marine Corps answers the call for improved quality of life. We'll have some tips on how to plan for your next driving trip. And sailors and Marines celebrate Thanksgiving aboard ship. Join me and Corporal Christiana Halsey for these stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
On Navy Marine Corps News, the Commandant of the Marine Corps answers the call for improved quality of life, some tips on how to plan for your next driving trip, and sailors and Marines celebrate Thanksgiving aboard ship. Join us for these stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News. The Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Corporal Christiana Halsey.
And I'm Chief Petty Officer Herb Josie. Thousands of sailors got some good news recently when they found out how they did on the September advancement exams. This is a sign that right-sizing in the Navy is nearly complete.
For the third cycle in a row, advancement numbers have gone up. According to the Bureau of Naval Personnel, advancement opportunities for pay grades E4 and E5 each rose 2%, and for first-class petty officers, the gain was 1%.
Of course, this is total numbers. This doesn't actually break down to each rating itself, but overall, the Navy is starting to stabilize a little and see a little progress and advancement opportunity increase as we come through the right-sizing effort.
BUPERS expects to continue to see advancement numbers go up. Their goal is to reach a steady state of advancement opportunity and for this opportunity to level out through each cycle.
I think it's a strong indication that we're coming through the right sizing effort and the billet file is stabilizing, and as vacancies exist, we're able to fill in and advance behind those.
Even though more sailors are being advanced, it's still important to prepare for the advancement exam.
Searchlight designed to withstand.
One of them still.
Petty Officer Derek Frazier, who was just selected for second, stresses that point.
I think it's very important to study for the exam, because if I hadn't studied, I wouldn't have made it this time. I found that out the hard way. The first couple of times I took the exam, it blew me away. So once I started studying, I started getting closer, and finally I made it.
It's also important to start your studying early and not wait until the last minute.
To try to cram last minute, a lot of times not possible. But if you get an early jump, you're going to be able to cover the most material and keep that in your mind.
You know, Chris, there's nothing like a promotion and a pay raise to improve a sailor's quality of life.
You would know that firsthand, wouldn't you,
Half
Chief?
Of it anyway.
Well, quality of life is just as important in the Marine Corps. Secretary of Defense William Perry's pledge to add $2.7 billion over the next 6 years to improve military members' quality of life was welcome news to the members of the sea services. Petty Officer Ron Flanders reports how the Corps is especially dedicated to improving the lives of its Marines.
The Marine Corps' portion of the funds will fit in nicely with work already accomplished at Camp Pendleton. Such things as improved bachelor enlisted quarters, a state-of-the-art enlisted dining facility, and high-quality on-base housing prove that the Corps is making life better for Marines and their families. But they're not done yet.
Our priorities will be toward housing, both on the bachelor and the married side, to be able to upgrade some of our current family housing, but equally important to that, if not perhaps even more important in certain respects, to be able to put some money into the barracks in which our junior enlisted people live.
Base housing at Pendleton is clean and safe, with safe recreation areas for kids. And that, combined with improved exchange and commissary facilities, makes it more comfortable for military families, something that's just as important to these Marines as good equipment.
I think right now it's time to finally take care of the Marines and their families some more, be good for them. Well, when you're overseas, you feel better, your morale's higher when you feel that your family can get things taken care of and that they're taken care of back home.
The money not only helps fund new programs, it marks a new era for the Marine Corps.
We want to make sure we've got a tremendously high quality armed force right now, and we want to make sure that we bring them up in a standard of living and all those sorts of things to the highest level we can, and that's taking care of your own.
Petty Officer Ron Flanders, Camp Pendleton.
You know, Chief, they're not only making improvements to housing, but they're also going to improve child care facilities, and they're going to make some increases in pays and allowances.
That's definitely good news for all military members and their families. And another important aspect of quality of life in the military is training. And the quality of training is what keeps the Navy Marine Corps team ready to fight forward from the sea. Corporal James Finch in Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, explains how sailors and Marines keep their battle skills up to date.
Marines in the rear provide support combat units need to take out bad guys. But if the rear is destroyed, that link is lost, and victory chances are cut drastically. That's why some units leave their offices and spend a week at the battle skills training school.
They have to supply their own security for rear security in the group, because the simple fact that the grunts aren't going to come back to help them or do their patrolling and their security measures. We get a lot of short notice classes, and the Marines are actually going real world action, so hopefully it is saving their lives and they're able to use what we teach them.
Students get to practice things like weapons firing, demolitions, and chemical warfare. The extensive training makes for 18-hour days, but most aren't irritated by the added stress.
This training is very important to me because we are all Marines first and our job second, and if there were ever a case that I would have to go off to war, I would need to know these things, not only to save my life, but my fellow Marines.
It gives me a lot of refresher on things that I learned when I first came in the Corps, and make sure that I don't forget the things that are most important.
In my job field, I'm the chaplain's bodyguard pretty much in combat, so I've never had this training before, so it's been really good for me.
Graduating some 6,000 students each year, the battle skills cadre has to prioritize. Units deploying to hot spots and support group personnel get first dibs, but nearly any unit can squeeze in for a training session.
We trained base Marines division. We trained over 500 CBs. We trained junior ROTC, both high school and college. We've had a Navy SEAL team from a reserve unit here. We've had everybody up to, including the Army here also. Pretty much if any division or base unit wants to use our school, they just have to contact G3 training for 2nd Emphasis G, and we'll lock on the requested training.
Practice makes perfect, and battle skills training is no exception. And that's why BST is important to all Marines and the sailors who support them. From the Gulf 3 Range, I'm Corporal James Finch.
Now that looks like something that you would really enjoy doing.
You know I would. I'd love to trudge through the mud.
I tell you, you would.
And staying up on your battle skills helps Marines stay ready for any mission, including humanitarian missions like the ones in Haiti and Guantanamo Bay. Mm-hmm.
Now we've been telling you about Guantanamo Bay and the migrant camps there for the past several months now. And as many people know, because of the migrant situation, families were evacuated from Gitmo in September.
Well, the Navy and Marine Corps took swift action to ensure these family separations are minimized. Petty Officer Bill Miles has the story.
This young woman expressed her feelings about having to pack up and leave Guantanamo Bay. She is only one of more than 1,000 Navy and Marine Corps family members who were evacuated last September because of the influx of Haitian and Cuban migrants there. And the sea services are now trying to ease the pain of separation. They're doing this by shortening tour lengths. No one in Gitmo will be involuntarily separated from their family for longer than 12 months, starting in September when the families were evacuated. Projected rotation dates, or PRDs, are being adjusted for all sailors on the island to not later than September 1995.
One of the reasons we're doing this is to provide some stability to our Navy families. So we're giving them a choice so that the families can make a decision as to their, you know, what to do with their lives and which type of career moves to make.
Families now have the choice of staying in their safe haven status or moving to their sponsor's new permanent duty station if they so desire. And because of the PRD changes, a team of detailers will visit Gitmo in early December to negotiate these new assignments.
Our whole objective here is to take care of the sailors. The families have been torn apart, and now we want to go down there by taking care of them to the best of our ability to go down and communicate to the sailors what their options are so that they can make intelligent and wise decisions for them and their families.
And so that tears like these won't last too long. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Bill Miles.
The Navy Marine Corps team is taking care of sailors and Marines by adjusting their rotation dates. All sailors and Marines on accompanied orders have had their PRDs adjusted to ensure they're not away from their families for more than 1 year. Now, the PRDs of sailors originally assigned for 18-month unaccompanied tours will also be adjusted to not later than September 1995.
When we come back, we'll tag along with the CNO as he visits sailors in the Persian Gulf during the Thanksgiving holiday.
And we'll have some news you can use, a few tips on how to plan for your next holiday road trip.
Don't go away.
It's bigger, bolder, better than ever.
It's Leyte. It opens clogged breathing tubes, refreshes like no other, and you can enjoy it wherever you go. Just listen to what satisfied people are already saying about their lives.
I wouldn't trade mine for anything.
I wouldn't be soaked without mine.
Well, there you have it. So don't miss out, because life
goes with everything.
Except drugs.
A message from a drug-free Navy and Marine Corps.
Nice.
Back to Navy Marine Corps News. While most of us were enjoying turkey and a day off on Thanksgiving, thousands of sailors and Marines were working for deployed around the world.
Mm-hmm. Now, being away from families and friends this time of year is hard on those men and women, and while nothing replaces being home for Thanksgiving, a visit from the Chief of Naval Operations and a good meal can help ease the Thanksgiving blues. Admiral Mike Borda spent Thanksgiving in the Persian Gulf. His visit took him to seven ships, where he thanked sailors for their sacrifice and told them why their deployment to the Gulf was important.
Saddam Hussein doesn't seem to get the message very well, and you send it in ways that he can't miss, just by being here and your capabilities.
Besides the usual subjects, quality of life, good leadership, and downsizing in the Navy, Admiral Borda had a basic message for sailors.
The real reason I came out here was to say Happy Thanksgiving.
And he said thanks to almost 100 sailors on those ships by pinning medals on them. These sailors aboard USS Reed got to see CNO power up close when he upgraded their letters of commendation to Navy Achievement Medals on the spot.
I didn't expect it. You know, I thought it was pretty neat when he did it to the officer, and I thought that's how far it was going to go. And then it just went right on down the line, and I was just pretty psyched out about it.
Meanwhile, sailors got ready for Thanksgiving feasts aboard ship by thinking about what they'd have for Turkey Day if they were at home.
The first thing that I miss about Thanksgiving is Mom's sweet potato pie.
Filling the mom role on USS Dwight D. Eisenhower is MS-2 Bruno Bednarski and the people like him who cook in the galleys.
We try to do our best at, you know, making Mom's best home-cooked gravy as we can do, but somebody still says it ain't like Mom's. I can't be everybody's mom, you know, but I try to be.
This Thanksgiving finds MS-1 Paul Polanski and his fellow cooks lighting up the kitchens with smells of apple and pumpkin pies, dinner rolls, baked ham, and of course,
we've got all kinds of turkeys in the oven.
These cooks make a special effort on this meal. They know a good meal on Thanksgiving means a lot to sailors who sacrifice time with their families to serve their country.
You do your best and everybody really appreciates it.
They cooked all night on the Eisenhower, 3,000 pounds of turkey, 600 pumpkin pies, 2,000 servings of cheesecake.
But we are in the cheese mess and we do give them what they want.
All that plus the trimmings helps make Thanksgiving aboard ship bearable. And the cooks are proud to play their part.
Well, when the plates come back, if the plates are cleared, you know it's a good meal. You don't really even need anybody to say anything. When the plates come back and the plates are empty, you know you did a good job.
And after the food's eaten, sailors have a different perspective on spending Thanksgiving with their shipmates in the Persian Gulf.
I'm here, you gotta love it. I'm with my shipmates and it's all good.
So, Chief, did you get a chance to sample some of those holiday goodies, or were you too busy shooting?
No, I made sure I got time in for eating. Now, I got a couple of plates of Thanksgiving dinner while I was on the Eisenhower.
But you didn't gain any weight.
No, an ounce or two. I ate a lot of food. You just can't notice it, that's all.
So where's the CNO off to next?
He's headed to Orlando for the last recruit graduation there, and he's going to make a quick road trip to the Army-Navy football game in Philadelphia.
Well, if you're planning to do any road trips, you'll be interested in our next story. Every year, thousands of sailors and Marines take off from their duty stations to visit their families, but many are involved in mishaps that could have been avoided if they had taken the time to plan their trip before heading off cross-country. Well, here's Petty Officer Diane Jacobs with an update on things you can do to help keep yourself out of trouble when traveling on the nation's highways.
Yes, we have the Christmas.
The snow chains.
Okay, I guess that takes care of everything. We're on our way.
Okay.
You ready, little guy?
Planning makes a big difference in how smooth your trip will be.
You want to know where you're going and what routing is safe, possibly during holiday season. You have weather conditions that you want to look at, so you'll want to have alternate routing planned for you.
The best thing is to take out a map and pre-plan what route you're going to take, preferably an interstate route, especially if there might be snow in the forecast.
Going to Denver, I would either show you your most direct would be going up 15 and across 70. Now you're going to get into some heavy weather conditions going across here because it goes across the Rocky Mountains. So what we would need to do is right before you leave on your trip, we would check road conditions.
Bad weather can change your route, but it also means you have to be prepared.
Warm clothing if you're anticipating an area like this where you get snow. Carrying chains inside the car, an ice scraper, chain pliers in order to put the chains on the vehicle. Extra blankets, flares, gloves, and warm clothing.
You may think you don't need chains for your car, but if Mother Nature dishes out an unexpected snowstorm, you may wish you had them.
If we stop you on a freeway area and we tell you that you can't go through without chains, you will not be allowed to go through without chains. You'll just have to wait until the conditions are such that we'll let you drive on the roadway.
Once you get out on the road, one of the biggest challenges is combating highway hypnotism. It's hard to stay awake. But if you have things like coffee, and you can roll down your windows, or you can listen to the radio and sing along if you like, or have someone to talk to, somebody like you, it makes it a lot easier. However, none of these are the best answer.
It's best just to pull over for a rest.
I would recommend that you stop at least every 2 hours. That'll give you a good idea in order to get out, walk around for a little bit, maybe get yourself something to drink, get some fresh air, make yourself just a little bit more awake.
If your body is telling you it needs sleep, pull over at the next rest stop or scenic point. And while at the rest stop, there are a few things to remember.
Make sure that all your windows and your doors are locked. You might want to take your valuables, hide your valuables underneath the seats, make them so that they're not visible.
Driving home for the holidays doesn't have to be the nightmare before Christmas. All it takes is some planning and some good safety precautions. Petty Officer Diane Jacobs, San Diego.
You know, Chief, looking at that trunk, you'd think that the car companies need to extend the trunk.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of safety gear that has to go in there. But seriously, those are some really important tips that you'll need to keep in mind. They'll keep you safe while you're on the road there.
There are some other safety concerns that sailors and Marines need to be aware of. There's a serious worldwide health problem you should all know about, and it's become the leading cause of death among young adults in the United States. That health problem is AIDS. And if you don't take the proper precautions, you can become infected with this deadly virus. Sailors and Marines are lost every year to diseases that could have been prevented, especially diseases like AIDS. In the past 10 years, AIDS, the acquired immune deficiency syndrome, has become a worldwide epidemic. HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus, is what causes AIDS. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention estimate more than 1 million people in the U.S. are currently infected with the virus. Sailors and Marines are not immune from its effects.
We continue to have between 200 and 300 of our sailors and Marines found HIV infected each year.
Frightening, isn't it? But you don't have to be afraid. You just have to know the facts. HIV is spread through blood, semen, vaginal fluids, and by sharing needles with an infected person. You cannot get the disease through casual contact like shaking hands or hugging.
Major misconception is probably it does not affect me. However, HIV is all around us. You can't look at someone and tell that they are HIV positive. You can only know that for fact by the testing.
To have a test done, go to your local clinic and ask to be tested for HIV and AIDS. The clinic will draw blood, analyze it, and should give you the results within several weeks. The best way to protect yourself is abstinence. If you don't, then take measures to reduce your risk. Unprotected sex can lead to disaster, so use a condom or make sure your partner uses one. By thinking ahead and being safe, you greatly reduce your risk of acquiring HIV or AIDS. The Navy Marine Corps team has a training program to help you better understand HIV and AIDS. The program requires all military and civilian members to attend the training. Now, if you have any questions about HIV and AIDS, don't hesitate to contact your local medical clinic or your training officer.
Thanks for that report, Chris. When we return, we'll head to downtown Chicago for a look at an exhibit that's out of this world.
And then it's off to Zagreb, Croatia, where doctors are on the cutting edge of technology.
Stay with us.
You know, hitting a windshield at 30 miles per hour is a lot like this.
I'd give you a 10, my friend, but you didn't keep your legs together.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your safety belt.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News. Over the past few weeks, we've shown you some of the benefits of being stationed at Great Lakes. And although you might not think about it, cities like Chicago along the Great Lakes, they're seafaring towns where Navy interest runs high.
That's why the Chicago Museum of Science and Industry put together a brand new exhibit that brings the fleet and its technology to the community. Petty Officer Dave Smith has the story.
It's the largest exhibit ever developed by Chicago's Museum of Science and Industry. The Navy Technology at Sea exhibit covers 10,000 square feet of the museum and just opened to the public this past June.
We wanted to do something that was much more of today's Navy, and so we designed this exhibit to show today's technology, the high-techness of what's going on, so people had a real feel for what our service people are doing offshore.
Large-scale replicas of three Navy ships give visitors the opportunity to experience the Navy firsthand. There's the destroyer USS Arleigh Burke, the submarine USS Chicago, and the aircraft carrier George Washington.
I enjoyed it very much. It, as I say, it makes you feel a little older because the technology is way beyond what it was.
Well, they seem to really enjoy it. Most notably, the F-14 Tomcat simulators that we have are a real big thrill for people, where they can get in there and feel like they're taking off of an aircraft carrier, doing a mission, and then coming back and tail hooking back on the carriers.
Hello and welcome aboard the F-14 Tomcat flight simulator. Your mission is to seek, dodge, and destroy enemy Scud missiles and one enemy aircraft launcher.
A crew from the museum filmed off the George Washington for several days with cameras mounted inside and outside of an F-14. With a combination of high-definition television and movement, this is what you get.
Flight simulator is something you... You can't describe it. It's like saying, we ought to see Grand Canyon. Well, it's one thing to say it, it's one thing to go and see it. And a simulator, if anybody's interested, is something you won't forget.
How was it?
It was great. It was neat. Yeah, I did. Sure did. It's fun.
Hardest part was the landing.
How was it, guys?
Good. Excellent. I'm ready to go serve my country right now.
Maybe not a bad recruiting tool either. Anyway, the display is a big hit. And as technology at sea progresses, the exhibit will log its course. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Dave Smith.
Did you see Dave flying that F-14?
Oh, yeah, he was really getting into it, wasn't he? Left, right, bank, and everything else.
I was getting thrown around.
Better than a video game, wasn't it? Whew. Looked like a lot of fun, but that's just another way that today's technology makes real-life experiences possible without loss of life or equipment. Now, medicine is another area where technology is making it possible to give our sailors and Marines the best quality care, even in remote, hostile locations around the world. Petty Officer Matthew Sinopoulos tells us more.
No one denies that service in the military is risky. The Navy ideal of a fast ship to go in harm's way underscores the inherent danger associated with military service. Even during peacetime, military operations can put sailors and Marines into situations where injury is possible, far from specialized medical help. The danger of sudden injury or illness aboard a ship underway, for example, has long been a concern of sailors and doctors alike. The Navy is now testing a new communication system in Zagreb, Croatia, that helps to bridge the gap between service members in the field and doctors in the hospitals.
Basically what it is what we call teleradiology system, and what it does is it gives us the ability to digitize and transmit x-rays back to the radiologist in either San Diego, California, or Bethesda, Maryland. And what it's done is given us the ability to leave the radiologist that's assigned to Fleet Hospitals to grab physically back in San Diego, but yet we still have the capability of him to read all our x-rays.
This new system allows doctors to participate in one of the most time-honored practices of the medical profession, that of consultation with a more knowledgeable colleague. Before this system was in place, doctors or independent duty corpsmen in isolated duty stations had to make critical decisions without the help of more experienced doctors or specialists. Now, these practitioners can broadcast x-ray and CAT scan images to hospitals and teleconference with experts in a particular medical field.
Last thing I needed to talk to you about was Reed's x-rays, just making sure that all 36 of those images came in and everybody was happy with what they seen.
Yeah, well, our other radio men in our department got deployed to the Mercury.
This capability dramatically improves the level of medical care available to sailors on deployed ships and in isolated posts. It also allows other professions to take advantage of knowledge possessed by subject matter experts.
Non-destructive testing personnel in aviation use the exact same x-rays for identifying stress fractures in aircraft. So if we had a unit like this up in Adak, Alaska, they could go ahead and x-ray the aircraft in question, go ahead and digitize the x-ray and send it back to wherever they needed to get it read.
Our thanks to Petty Officer Matthew Sinopoulos for providing that story.
Now on the other side of the world, sailors and Marines in the Pacific region helped commemorate the 50th anniversary of what historians consider the major turning point of World War II.
Petty Officer Jason Mitchell tells us about the veterans who returned to the Leyte Gulf to help us remember.
Almost 10,000 American and Filipino World War II veterans came from the four corners of the globe to pay witness to the commemoration of Leyte Gulf. 50 years ago, the vets were involved in the turning point of the Pacific War when General Douglas MacArthur waded ashore to make good on his famous promise. Some of the vets remembered the day as vividly as yesterday.
I think about the people that we were with, the shipmates. It's very emotional to come back and see them again. I think it's a stronger relationship than family, really.
The U.S. and Philippine Navies combined forces after the reenactment to demonstrate modern fighting capabilities for the vets. Up from the sea, across the land, and down from the air, the different special forces units hit the beach.
This whole thing is focused on the veterans, and that's why we're here. So I'm looking forward to rubbing elbows with some of the veterans, hearing some of the stories, things you don't read in books, you know, things they'll tell you about.
When I hit the beach, they were shooting at us, we hit the dirt, and when I looked up, there was a palm leaf laying in front of me, and under this palm leaf was a landmine. Come that close. If I'd just been a foot further in, I wouldn't be here today.
The victory in the Pacific was not without the casualties of war. Each vet able to attend the commemoration carried with them the memories of the 3,000 friends lost in the liberation. Petty Officer Jason Mitchell, Leyte Gulf, Republic of the Philippines.
That was a pretty convincing reenactment of General MacArthur's return to the Philippines.
Yes, it was. Well, that's our show for this week. I'm Christiana Halsey.
And I'm Herb Josie. Before we go, we'd like to give you a look at the December edition of All Hands magazine. This month's issue takes you around the world to look at naval forces deployed forward from the sea.
We'd also like to take this opportunity to thank those of you who have called our feedback line with your comments and suggestions. Keep those calls and emails coming. We appreciate your input.
Mm-hmm. Now, here's our number for the Navy Marine Corps News feedback line. It's area code 202-433-6108 or DSN 288-6108. Just leave us a message on the machine anytime, day or night.
We also have an email address if you'd like to send us a computer message. Here's where to send the email. And if you didn't have time to write it down, look in your weekly NAV News message. We look forward to hearing from you.
Well, that's it for the show. We'll leave you with a look at some of our silent warriors as they work forward from the sea. Have a great week. For the third cycle in a row, advancement numbers have gone up. According to the Bureau of Naval Personnel, advancement opportunities for pay grades E4 and E5 each rose 2%, and for first-class petty officers, the gain was 1%.
Of course, this is total numbers. This doesn't actually break down to each rating itself, but overall, the Navy is starting to stabilize a little and see a little progress in advancement opportunity increase as we come through the right-sizing effort.
BUPERS expects to continue to see advancement numbers go up. Their goal is to reach a steady state of advancement opportunity and for this opportunity to level out through each cycle.
I think it's a strong indication that we're coming through the right sizing effort and the billet file is stabilizing, and as vacancies exist, we're able to fill in and advance behind those.
Even though more sailors are being advanced, it's still important to prepare for the advancement exam.
Searchlight designed to withstand.
One of them's the
Petty Officer Derek Frazier, who was just selected for second, stresses that point.
I think it's very important to study for the exam, because if I hadn't studied, I wouldn't have made it this time. I found that out the hard way. The first couple of times I took the exam, it blew me away. So once I started studying, I started getting closer, and finally I made it.
It's also important to start your studying early and not wait until the last minute.
To try to cram last minute, a lot of times not possible. But if you get an early jump, you're going to be able to cover the most material and keep that in your mind.
Accomplished at Camp Pendleton. Such things as improved bachelor enlisted quarters, a state-of-the-art enlisted dining facility, and high-quality on-base housing prove that the Corps is making life better for Marines and their families. But they're not done yet.
Our priorities will be toward housing, both on the bachelor and the married side, to be able to upgrade some of our current family housing, but equally important to that, if not perhaps even more important in certain respects, to be able to put some money into the barracks in which our junior enlisted people live.
Base housing at Pendleton is clean and safe, with safe recreation areas for kids. And that, combined with improved exchange and commissary facilities, makes it more comfortable for military families. Something that's just as important to these Marines as good equipment.
I think right now it's time to finally take care of the Marines and their families some more. Be good for them. Well, when you're overseas, you feel better, your morale's higher when you feel that your family can get things taken care of and that they're taken care of back home.
The money not only helps fund new programs, it marks a new era for the Marine Corps.
We want to make sure we've got a tremendously high quality armed force right now, and we want to make sure that we bring them up in a standard of living and all those sorts of things to the highest level we can, and that's taking care of your own.
Petty Officer Ron Flanders, Camp Pendleton.
Marines in the rear provide support combat units need to take out bad guys. But if the rear is destroyed, that link is lost, and victory chances are cut drastically. That's why some units leave their offices and spend a week at the Battle Skills Training School.
They have to supply their own security for rear security in the group, because the simple fact that the grunts aren't going to come back to help them or do their patrolling and their security measures. We get a lot of short notice classes, and the Marines are actually going real world action, so hopefully it is saving their lives and they're able to use what we teach them.
Students get to practice things like weapons firing, demolitions, and chemical warfare. The extensive training makes for 18-hour days, but most aren't irritated by the added stress.
This training is very important to me because we are all Marines first and our job second. And if there were ever a case that I would have to go off to war, I would need to know these things, not only to save my life, but my fellow Marines.
It gives me a lot of refresher on things that I learned when I first came in the Corps, and make sure that I don't forget the things that are most important.
In my job field, I'm the chaplain's bodyguard pretty much in combat, so I've never had this training before, so it's been really good for me.
Graduating some 6,000 students each year, the Battle Skills Cadre has to prioritize. Units deploying to hot spots and support group personnel get first dibs. but nearly any unit can squeeze in for a training session.
We trained base Marines division. We trained over 500 CBs. We trained junior ROTC, both high school and college. We've had a Navy SEAL team from a reserve unit here. We've had everybody up to, including the Army here also. Pretty much if any division or base unit wants to use our school, they just have to contact G3 training for 2nd Emphasis G and we'll lock on the requested training.
Practice makes perfect and battle skills training is no exception. And that's why BST is important to all Marines and the sailors who support them. From the Gulf 3 Range, I'm Corporal James Finch.
This young woman expressed her feelings about having to pack up and leave Guantanamo Bay. She is only one of more than 1,000 Navy and Marine Corps family members who were evacuated last September because of the influx of Haitian and Cuban migrants there. And the sea services are now trying to ease the pain of separation. They're doing this by shortening tour lengths. No one in Gitmo will be involuntarily separated from their family for longer than 12 months, starting in September when the families were evacuated. Projected rotation dates, or PRDs, are being adjusted for all sailors on the island to not later than September 1995.
One of the reasons we're doing this is to provide some stability to our Navy families. So we're giving them a choice so that the families can make a decision as to their, you know, what to do with their lives and which type of career moves to make.
Families now have the choice of staying in their safe haven status or moving to their sponsor's new permanent duty station if they so desire. And because of the PRD changes, a team of detailers will visit Gitmo in early December to negotiate these new assignments.
Our whole objective here is to take care of the sailors. The families have been torn apart, and now we want to go down there by taking care of them to the best of our ability to go down and communicate to the sailors what their options are so that they can make intelligent and wise decisions for them and their families.
And so that tears like these won't last too long. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Bill Miles.
Admiral Mike Borda spent Thanksgiving in the Persian Gulf. His visit took him to 7 ships, where he thanked sailors for their sacrifice and told them why their deployment to the Gulf was important.
Saddam Hussein doesn't seem to get the message very well, and you send it in ways that he can't miss just by being here and your capabilities.
Besides the usual subjects, quality of life, good leadership, and downsizing in the Navy, Admiral Borda had a basic message for sailors.
The real reason I came out here was to say Happy Thanksgiving.
And he said thanks to almost 100 sailors on those ships by pinning medals on them. These sailors aboard USS Reed got to see CNO Power up close when he upgraded their letters of commendation to Navy Achievement Medals on the spot.
I didn't expect it. You know, I thought it was pretty neat when he did it to the officer, and I thought that's how far it was going to go. And then it just went right on down the line, and I was just pretty psyched out about it.
Meanwhile, sailors got ready for Thanksgiving feasts aboard ship by thinking about what they'd have for Turkey Day if they were at home.
The first thing that I miss about Thanksgiving is Mom's sweet potato pie.
Filling the mom role on USS Dwight D. Eisenhower is MS-2 Bruno Bednarski and the people like him who cook in the galleys.
We try to do our best at, you know, making Mom's best home-cooked gravy as we can do, but somebody still says it ain't like Mom's. I can't be everybody's mom, you know? But I try to be.
This Thanksgiving finds MS-1 Paul Polanski and his fellow cooks lighting up the kitchens with smells of apple and pumpkin pies, dinner rolls, baked ham, and of course,
we've got all kinds of turkeys in the oven.
These cooks make a special effort on this meal. They know a good meal on Thanksgiving means a lot to sailors who sacrifice time with their families to serve their country.
You do your best and everybody really appreciates it.
They cooked all night on the Eisenhower, 3,000 pounds of turkey, 600 pumpkin pies, 2,000 servings of cheesecake.
But we are in the cheese mess and we do give them what they want.
All that plus the trimmings helps make Thanksgiving aboard ship bearable, and the cooks are proud to play their part.
Well, when the plates come back, if the plates are cleared, you know it's a good meal. You don't really even need anybody to say anything. When the plates come back and the plates are empty, you know you did a good job.
And after the food's eaten, sailors have a different perspective on spending Thanksgiving with their shipmates in the Persian Gulf.
I'm here. You gotta love it. I'm with my shipmates, and it's all good.
Christmas presents.
Yes, we have the Christmas.
The snow chains.
Snow chains.
Okay, I guess that takes care of everything. We're on our way.
Okay.
You ready, little guy?
Planning makes a big difference in how smooth your trip will be.
You want to know where you're going and what routing is safe. Possibly during holiday season, you have weather conditions that you want to look at. So you'll want to have alternate routing planned for you.
The best thing is to take out a map and pre-plan what route you're going to take, preferably an interstate route, especially if there might be snow in the forecast.
Going to Denver, I would either show you your most direct would be going up 15 and across 70. Now you're going to get into some heavy weather conditions going across here because it goes across the Rocky Mountains. So what we would need to do is right before you leave on your trip, we would check road conditions.
Bad weather can change your route, but it also means you have to be prepared.
Warm clothing if you're anticipating an area like this where you get snow. Carrying chains inside the car, an ice scraper, chain pliers in order to put the chains on the vehicle, extra blankets, flares, gloves, and warm clothing.
You may think you don't need chains for your car, but if Mother Nature dishes out an unexpected snowstorm, you may wish you had them.
If we stop you on a freeway area and we tell you that you can't go through without chains, you will not be allowed to go through without chains. You'll just have to wait until the conditions are such that we'll let you drive on the roadway.
Once you get out on the road, one of the biggest challenges is combating highway hypnotism. It's hard to stay awake, but if you have things like coffee, then you can roll down your windows, or you can listen to the radio and sing along if you like, or have someone to talk to, somebody like you. It makes it a lot easier. However, none of these are the best answer.
It's best just to pull over for a rest.
I would recommend that you stop at least every 2 hours. That'll give you a good idea in order to get out, walk around for a little bit, maybe get yourself something to drink, get some fresh air, make yourself just a little bit more awake.
If your body is telling you it needs sleep, pull over at the next rest stop or scenic point. And while at the rest stop, there are a few things to remember.
Make sure that all your windows and your doors are locked. You might want to take your valuables, hide your valuables underneath the seats, make them so that they're not visible.
Driving home for the holidays doesn't have to be the nightmare before Christmas. All it takes is some planning and some good safety precautions. Petty Officer Diane Jacobs, San Diego.
Marines are lost every year to diseases that could have been prevented, especially diseases like AIDS. In the past 10 years, AIDS, the acquired immune deficiency syndrome, has become a worldwide epidemic. HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus, is what causes AIDS. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention estimate more than 1 million people in the U.S. are currently infected with the virus. Sailors and Marines are not immune from its effects.
We continue to have between 200 and 300 of our sailors and Marines found HIV infected each year.
Frightening, isn't it? But you don't have to be afraid. You just have to know the facts. HIV is spread through blood, semen, vaginal fluids, and by sharing needles with an infected person. You cannot get the disease through casual contact like shaking hands or hugging.
Major misconception is probably it does not affect me. However, HIV is all around us. You can't look at someone and tell that they are HIV positive. You can only know that for fact by the testing.
To have a test done, go to your local clinic and ask to be tested for HIV and AIDS. The clinic will draw blood, analyze it, and should give you the results within several weeks. The best way to protect yourself is abstinence. If you don't, then take measures to reduce your risk. Unprotected sex can lead to disaster, so use a condom or make sure your partner uses one.
By thinking ahead and being safe, you greatly reduce your risk of acquiring HIV or AIDS.
It's the largest exhibit ever developed by Chicago's Museum of Science and Industry. The Navy Technology at Sea exhibit covers 10,000 square feet of the museum and just opened to the public this past June.
We wanted to do something that was much more of today's Navy, and so we designed this exhibit to show today's technology, the high-techness of what's going on, so people had a real feel for what our service people are doing offshore.
Large-scale replicas of three Navy ships give visitors the opportunity to experience the Navy firsthand. There's the destroyer USS Arleigh Burke, the submarine USS Chicago, and the aircraft carrier George Washington.
I enjoyed it very much. As I say, it makes you feel a little older because the technology is way beyond what it was.
Well, they seem to really enjoy it. Most notably, the F-14 Tomcat simulators that we have are a real big thrill for people, where they can get in there and feel like they're taking off of an aircraft carrier, doing a mission, and then coming back and tail hooking back on the carriers.
Hello and welcome aboard the F-14 Tomcat flight simulator. Your mission is to seek, dodge, and destroy enemy Scud missiles and one enemy aircraft launcher.
A crew from the museum filmed off the George Washington for several days with cameras mounted inside and outside of an F-14. With a combination of high-definition television and movement, this is what you get.
Flight simulator is something you can't describe. It's like saying, well, you ought to see Grand Canyon. Well, it's one thing to say it, and it's one thing to go and see it. And a simulator, if anybody's interested, is something you won't forget.
How was it?
It was great. It was neat. Yeah, I did. Sure did. It was fun.
Hardest part was the landing.
How was it, guys?
Good. Excellent. I'm ready to go serve my country right now.
Maybe not a bad recruiting tool either. Anyway, the display is a big hit. And as technology at sea progresses, the exhibit will log its course. For Navy Marine Corps News, I'm Petty Officer Dave Smith.
No one denies that service in the military is risky. The Navy ideal of a fast ship to go in harm's way underscores the inherent danger associated with military service. Even during peacetime, military operations can put sailors and Marines into situations where injury is possible, far from specialized medical help. The danger of sudden injury or illness aboard a ship underway, for example, has long been a concern of sailors and doctors alike. The Navy is now testing a new communication system in Zagreb, Croatia, that helps to bridge the gap between service members in the field and doctors in the hospitals.
Basically what it is what we call a teleradiology system, and what it does is it gives us the ability to digitize and transmit x-rays back to the radiologist in either San Diego, California, or Bethesda, Maryland. And what it's done is given us the ability to leave the radiologist that's assigned to Fleet Hospital Zagreb physically back in San Diego, but yet we still have the capability of him to read all our x-rays.
This new system allows doctors to participate in one of the most time-honored practices of the medical profession, that of consultation with a more knowledgeable colleague. Before this system was in place, doctors were independent duty corpsmen in isolated duty stations, had to make critical decisions without the help of more experienced doctors or specialists. Now, these practitioners can broadcast x-ray and CAT scan images to hospitals and teleconference with experts in a particular medical field.
Last thing I needed to talk to you about was Reed's x-rays, just making sure that all 36 of those images came in and everybody was happy with what they seen.
Yeah, well, our other radiomen in our department got deployed to the emergency.
This capability dramatically improves the level of medical care available to sailors on deployed ships and in isolated posts. It also allows other professions to take advantage of knowledge possessed by subject matter experts.
Non-destructive testing personnel and aviation use the exact same x-rays for identifying stress fractures in aircraft. So if we had a unit like this up in Adak, Alaska, they could go ahead and x-ray the aircraft in question, go ahead and digitize the x-ray and send it back to wherever they needed to get it read.
Almost 10,000 American and Filipino World War II veterans came from the four corners of the globe to pay witness to the commemoration of Leyte Gulf. 50 years ago, the vets were involved in the turning point of the Pacific War when General Douglas MacArthur waded ashore to make good on his famous promise. Some of the vets remembered the day as vividly as yesterday.
I think about the people that we were with, the shipmates. It's very emotional to come back and see them again. I think it's a stronger relationship than family, really.
The U.S. and Philippine navies combined forces after the reenactment to demonstrate modern fighting capabilities for the vets. Up from the sea, across the land, and down from the air, the different special forces units hit the beach.
This whole thing is focused on the veterans, and that's why we're here. So I'm looking forward to rubbing elbows with some of the veterans, hearing some of the stories, things you don't read in books, you know, things they'll tell you about.
When I hit the beach, they were shooting at us. We hit the dirt. And when I looked up, there was a palm leaf laying in front of me, and under this palm leaf was a landmine. Come that close. If I'd just been a foot further in, I wouldn't be here today.
The victory in the Pacific was not without the casualties of war. Each vet able to attend the commemoration carried with them the memories of the 3,000 friends lost in the liberation. Petty Officer Jason Mitchell, Leyte Gulf, Republic of the Philippines.